Welcome back to Global with me, Matthew Amariola. Now, will there ever come a time when robots and human-like creations made by computer graphics will be able to work alongside human beings in everyday roles? Will they even take over tasks and jobs that we do and we'll be accepting them? And is it a feasible replacement? And will there come a time when we can't actually tell what is human and what is human-made creation? Well, joining me in the studios, as well as all of these machines to discuss this, is the animation expert Nigel Medhurst from the London Metropolitan University, and robotics expert Nigel Crook from Oxford Brookes University, who's brought, as you can see, two of his robots in with him. Thank you, gents, both of you, for joining us and bringing this extraordinary array of gadgets. Nigel, to you, first of all. I mean, the first thing to say about this, when you look all around me, is just the speed. When you see something like that, and that is computer-generated.
Absolutely.
The speed of progress is quite extraordinary, isn't it?
It's incredible. It's incredible. The fact that this has still come from a traditional media, which goes back to 2D animation. Our students, Oxford Brookes students, would have had to sort of storyboard this and map this out and actually thought that there is a character under here. But all of these are polygons. There's maths underneath all this stuff.
Let's just run the whole of how it's put together. Just tell me briefly how you actually go about putting this together. How long does it take?
Well, the process itself, I mean, for a typical student, for a typical sort of modeler and designer, you start off with the storyboarding, you start off with some early stage prototypes, an animatic that might take about 2 or 3 sort of weeks, and then you go into early stage modeling where you actually sort of shape with probably a box to start with, a cube shape, and then you push all the areas. There's elements in here called vertices and faces, and you slowly but surely you shape the character you see behind there.
It's amazing, because I've seen this a couple of times today, but still, even when you see it on the screen, it is staggering, isn't it, in terms
Absolutely.
Of its reality?
Absolutely.
Nigel, I suppose, first of all, I better get you to introduce me to your friends.
Yes. So this is Eddie, our head and neck robot, and we've built him to try and model the way human heads move during conversation. So when you're speaking to someone, they nod their head and move it around. That's actually quite a complex movement. So that's what we're studying with that robot. Artie is a robot we're using, again, to study human-robot interaction. And he's designed to educate and to entertain people. He's a robo-thespian.
I'll give a little demonstration of that a little later. I mean, it's fair to say, when you see what we had there on computer, this is much more like you would expect with robots. In terms of that progression, it hasn't quite happened as quickly, has it, in that particular area?
Well, it hasn't in terms of movement. In terms of look, there are some very, very realistic robots out there, geminoids, primarily developed in Japan, that look completely human-like until they move. And the movement is the most challenging.
And that's what you do, a lot of work on movement. Yeah. And I think with this one, you're going to actually show us some of the neck movement, because what you're trying to do, if I paraphrase your work, is to try to get that movement as close and human-like as possible. Is that right? Just give us
that's
a demonstration.
Right. Yeah, so hopefully, if I press this, Eddie will nod. It doesn't look very human-like at the moment. Doing some sort of funny neck dance. But what you can see him doing there with his neck is something that this robot, Artie, can't do, because Artie has an engineered neck. It's designed just to do some basic movements. He doesn't have a spine, and he doesn't have muscles that control his neck in the same way that Eddie does.
And just briefly on that, how complex is that, to get that sort of movement that is almost lifelike?
It's very complex. I mean, we still haven't got the neck right. We still have got a lot of work on the structure of the neck. But in terms of once it's built, it's also difficult to get it to do the behavior, because we don't actually know how to program this directly to control the 8 muscles so that it will do the subtle head movements that we want. It'll have to learn how to do it.
So quite a lot of work to do. Nigel, coming back to your work, I mean, we've seen in the news a very high-profile case only a couple of weeks ago with the use of a computer-generated, it was called Sweetie, which was a sting operation to trap paedophiles, and it was successful.
Indeed.
Because people actually thought that was real and connected, and of course we're trapped.
Absolutely. I mean, it's a very fine line, actually, and it's blurring all the time between what I'm doing as a animation tutor, what we're doing as a university, and what Nigel's doing with his colleagues at Oxford Brookes on AI. We can certainly now, as animators, capture data from sensors, feed it into software that exists already, and actually map, similar to what perhaps Andy Serkis did with Gollum, to actually map the movements of an actor
in there. Which takes us on to one of the questions I posed in the introduction about our approach, the human's approach, to all of this, how we interact. How much is that changing, do you think?
I think it's changing quite a bit. I mean, if you look on a standard tube train or any public transport, Matthew, everyone seems to have a mobile now. And I think the barriers are actually breaking down quite considerably. And an aversion towards actually dealing with a non-face-to-face communication is slowly losing, shall we say. It's slowly disappearing, going to the background.
And, Nigel, only a few weeks ago, we were discussing on this programme a remarkable experiment in Canada where they actually put a robot hitchhiker on the road, programmed to hitchhike across Canada. And remarkably, it was successful. I mean, they were thinking perhaps it might be stolen, put in the trash, tampered with. Actually, it got from East Coast to West Coast. People did engage with it. Yeah. And that is, those are areas that are developing all the time.
They are, and the very interesting way in which robots, which people can interact with robots, especially in public places. So we, for example, recently, this robot, Artie, did three nights in a comedy club as a stand-up comedian.
You're kidding. No.
This was work done by colleagues at Queen Mary University. They had a script and they had cameras that were looking at the faces of the audience and judging whether they were laughing and engaging, and he was adjusting his
And that's
routine.
All artificial intelligence, isn't
that's
it? And
all
that is
AI
another of the areas
control.
That...
It's all pre-programmed. Yeah. But he's using sensors to figure out if the audience is engaging with the routine and adjusting what he's doing accordingly.
So it can adapt according to what they're actually seeing in terms of evidence in front of them, is that right?
That's correct, yeah.
That's right. We've got a Pakistani comedian coming on later. He'll probably be spooked by all of that. And just that whole notion, the other phrase that we were throwing around a little earlier that perhaps people won't be familiar is this whole notion of the uncanny valley. Now, that is a notion that, as it becomes more realistic, actually, we get a little more uncomfortable as human beings. Do you think that is
Absolutely.
How we're all programmed, that actually if it gets too lifelike, there's something that just is, it's unsettling?
Well, the nuances, and again, our face-to-face, the three-way conversation we're having here, I think these are a difficult barrier to break through, but there are tools within the existing software out there to actually give a lift of an eyebrow, a move of a mouse, a hand gesture, which can be programmed through code or actually done in a traditional style as well.
Almost out of time, just in a phrase, both of you, 5 or 10 years' time, where will we be in terms of uses with all of this, do you think?
Well, certainly Google are looking now at nanotechnology. I understand that I think the barriers have broken down so much now that we, potentially, as an individual, might be immortal? I don't know. There might be a life there. We might be self-healing. That's the way I feel.
Bold claim, Nigel. What do you think?
I think in that time we'll be seeing more and more robots in public spaces. So shop assistants, for example, could guide you to the aisle in which the product you're interested in is located. I could see that happening in 5 or 10 years' time.
Well, it is a fascinating area, and thank you, gentlemen, for coming in. Thank you too for bringing in all of this for us to have a look at. Now, normally about this time we have our programme trails and music. Nigel was just telling us that Artie does a bit of stand-up comedy. He's actually going to sing us out in this particular part of the programme. So, way to go.
I'm singing in the rain, just singing in the rain. What a glorious feeling, I'm happy again. I'm laughing at clouds so dark up above. The sun's in my heart and I'm ready for love.